Hi, so in the last lecture we saw Tucker's lemma and its equivalence with the Borsuk-Ulam theorem. Okay, geometric proof of Borsuk-Ulam theorem. We now turn to the direct applications of Borsuk-Ulam theorem. So one by one there will be a few applications which we will see. So in today's lecture we'll see the ham sandwich theorem, various versions we'll see. Okay, so what informally it says is that if you take any sandwich which is made up of ham, cheese and bread, then you have a planar cut that will simultaneously halve all three of these, the ham, the cheese and the bread. Okay, and mathematically if I would want to state it, I will say that any D mass distributions in RD, so you can see this as a mass. Okay, ham is something which has volume. So D mass distributions in RD can be simultaneously bisected by a hyperplane. So this is actually a R3 version. So you are saying sandwich of course exists in R3, right? So you have a sandwich which is in R3, which has three mass distributions, ham, cheese and bread. Then you have a planar cut. Planar cut is exactly like plane, which is a hyperplane in R3. So you have a R2, which is going to simultaneously bisect all these three. Okay, so a d-dimensional version would be any d mass distribution in RD can be simultaneously bisected by a hyperplane. Of course, I'm working with finite d. And to prove this, we'll prove a statement about equipartitioning suitable finite Borel measures. Okay, so you will have D Borel measures on RD and you would want to equipartition these measures. And that is the first step towards the ham sandwich theorem. So just to recall, a finite Borel measure on RD is a measure such that all open subsets of RD are measurable and have finite positive value. Okay, so I'm always dealing with finite valued measures. So for the measures, the ham sandwich theorem version says that if you have mu 1, mu 2, mu d, d many finite Borel measures in RD such that every hyperplane has measure 0 for each of the mu i's, then you have a hyperplane H such that mu I of H plus is half the mu I of R of D. Okay, H plus is one of the half spaces which is being defined by this hyperplane H. Okay, so finite Borel measures mu I on RD with the property that every hyperplane has measure 0 for each of the mu i's will be termed as mass distributions. This is just something which we'll need later. Okay, nothing as of right now. So coming to the proof, let u bar be a point u0 ud in SD and I let that one of the points from u1 to ud is non-zero. So of course it's a point in SD, so either there is just one point which survives or some point has to survive, right? Either u0 or u1 or ud, one of the points has to be non-zero. So I am right now considering those points of SD for which one of the points starting from u1 to ud is non-zero. Clearly, if u0 is non-zero and rest all are zeros, I am either standing at north pole or the south pole of SD, right? So suppose some ui is non-zero for I in D. Remember, this bracket D just means the points 1 up till D. Then I define the hyperplane half space for this particular point u as those points of RD such that the summation ui xi is less than equal to u0. Okay, so it's like at u0 I am doing the partition and you see on the one side you have this half space, on the other side you have the exactly opposite half space. So this is a half space for such points. If u bar is equal to minus v bar, which means if you have a pair of antipodal points here, okay, then you also know that u0 is going to be minus of v0, right? The first coordinate also is the negative. So you know that the corresponding half spaces are exactly opposite to each other. Okay, so if something like this is your half space, a hyperplane which is coming through this, and on this side you have the corresponding points for u, for the minus u, you're going to have points on this side. So these are exactly the opposite half spaces. And what happens if you have actually hit one of the north or the south pole? So if let the u0 is u0, 0, 0, 0, which means u0 is either z plus 1 or minus 1. So if you have plus 1, from this definition, you say that all those points such that summation ui xi is less than or equal to 1. But now all the ui's are 0, right? So it contains actually all the points of Rd. So therefore h plus of 1, 0, 0, 0 is Rd. On the other hand, if you are at the south pole, which is minus 1 times 0, minus 1 comma 0, 0, 0, the same definition tells me that all those points such that summation ui xi is less than or equal to minus 1. But all ui is in being 0 implies that this summation is 0. So 0 less than or equal to minus 1. That is absurdity, which means I have no points and h plus of this particular point will be defined as the empty space. Okay, using all this data, now I define my function f from SD to RD. How I define it? So f automatically is a multivalued function, right? It takes a point of SD and sends it to a point in RD. So you have these d many coordinates for f. So for each coordinate, this is how we are defining. So fi of a point u is defined to be mu I, the ith measure, Borel measure, which is given to us in the theorem statement. Okay. Fi of u is defined to be the ith Borel measure of the half space defined by this point u. Okay. We claim that this function f, which we have defined here, is continuous. Excuse me. To say this, let's take a point of sequence in SD, UN, okay, which converges to the point U. And then to show the continuity of F, I would want to show that F of this entire thing converges to F of U, right? But F of U is exactly this. And F of UN is going to be Fi of UNs. And Fi of un's are mu I of h plus of un. So what I'm really saying is that to show that f is continuous, I start with a sequence un of points in SD, and we would want to show that mu I of h plus of un converges to mu I of h plus of u. Now this is easy to see that if there is a point x which is not on the boundary of this hyperplane, or rather the one to which we want to converge to, if it is not on the boundary, then after a large enough n, these points will start lying on this boundary if and only if they are lying on this boundary. Correct? The points will be here if and only if the points are here after a large enough n, right? Which we call as the tail. So if g and gn denotes the characteristic function of h plus and h plus of un, so characteristic function, let's just see first. So g as the characteristic function of h plus u means that I am defining g as a function on the points of SD such that g of x bar is going to be 1 if x bar is a point in h plus of u. Okay. If x lies in this half space and it is 0 otherwise. Okay, so this is the characteristic function for H plus U. Similarly, Gn we define as a characteristic function for H plus of Un, which means Gn of X is going to be 1 if X belongs to H plus of Un, and Gn X is going to be 0 if X does not belong to H plus of Un. Okay. Now, also, since these are mass distributions, we know that any hyperplane has measure 0 for each of these Ui's. So we know that boundary of H plus U has mu I measure as 0, right? This defines a hyperplane, correct? It's a boundary. So this has mu I measure as 0 as per our assumption. Therefore, Gn will converge to G mu I almost everywhere, right? And therefore, by the Lebesgue dominated convergence theorem, we have that mu I of H plus Un, which can be written as the integration of Gn d mu I, this converges to integration of G d mu I, because this is converging to Gn converges to G mu I almost everywhere. Therefore, this integration converges to this. But then this, by Lebesgue dominated convergence theorem, is mu I of H plus of U. Why? Because all the Gn's are dominated by 1. Since Gn's are characteristic functions, so Gn X is less than or equal to 1 for any X and any N. And therefore, they are integrable because mu I is finite. So the Lebesgue dominated convergence theorem tells me that mu I of H plus Un converges to mu I of H plus of U, right? So this tells me that F is continuous. Now, coming back to the main portion of the lecture, I started with that these are applications of Borsuk-Ulam theorem. But so far, there is no mention as such. How do I see the usefulness of Borsuk-Ulam theorem is that now once you have F as a continuous function defined in this fashion, we further see that if f of x is f of minus x for some x in SD, then the boundary of this particular half space being defined by this particular point x is the desired hyperplane. Okay. And to see why this will be a desired hyperplane, you just substitute values that f of x is going to be mu naught of h plus x and so on. And if this is equal to f of minus x, then this is same as mu naught of h plus of minus x and so on. Component wise, if you compare, you are going to get that mu naught of h plus x is same as mu naught of h plus of minus x. And we already know that antipodal points of SD correspond to opposite half spaces. Therefore, you will get that mu I of h plus is exactly half the mu I of RD, provided one of the points from x1 to xd is non-zero. Okay, remember all this business was done over this, because if this is the case but u happens to be north pole or south pole, then they are not the half spaces, because for those points, once you have RD, another one you have as the empty space, correct? So now I want to ensure that I have such a point which is away from these. Okay. So to see this, if suppose f of 1, 0, 0 is same as f of minus 1, 0, 0, 0, this would mean that mu I of RD is same as mu I of empty. But that is not possible, certainly. This is zero and this is positive. Okay. So these points are certainly not this. But then why does such a point exist? This point exists because of the Borsuk-Ulam theorem. Recall that if you have a continuous function from SD to RD, then the Borsuk-Ulam theorem version BU1A says that there is a point x in SD such that f of x is f of minus x. Therefore, and already we know that this is not a point of this form because that would give a contradiction. Therefore, this x, which comes from the Borsuk-Ulam theorem version BU1A, is a point of the form where one of the x1, x2 up till xd is non-zero. And hence, for this point x, the corresponding h plus x is the desired, the boundary of this is going to be the desired hyperplane. This hyper half space does the job. Okay, so this is the this is a nice application of Borsuk-Ulam theorem. We'll see its second version now, which is about the ham sandwich theorem for point sets. These were mass distributions, right? Oops, these were for mass distributions. You had some solid stuff, but suppose you have a discrete version in some sense. So by that, what I really mean is that if you have sets of points instead of volumes. So if you have, let's say, A1, A2, AD, A2B subsets of RD that are finite point sets, then there is a hyperplane H that simultaneously bisects each of these AIs. Okay, so there is a hyperplane which is going to bisect A1, A2 up to AD, all of them at the same time. That is what ham sandwich theorem for point sets says. First of all, before we go into the proof, let's just see what we really mean by bisecting here. So when we say that a hyperplane bisects a finite point set A, we really mean that. So it's a hyperplane, so it's going to divide your space into two half spaces, two open half spaces, right? So the entire space minus this hyperplane consists of two open half spaces. So bisecting a half finite point set A means that each of these open half spaces that are defined by this hyperplane contains at most the floor of half the points of A. Okay, this is a notation for floor of the value. So 5 by 2 is 2.5, its floor is 2. Okay, therefore, if you have odd cardinality set, then each of the open half spaces can contain at most k many points. 2k plus 1 by 2 is k plus half. So that half will be absorbed by this floor function, you will be left with k. So each of the half spaces can contain at most k many points of the set A. But let's say at most k points goes in one of the half spaces, let's say here, and another k points goes, at most k point goes here, then on this hyperplane also there has to be at least one point, right? To match up the cardinality, this is what we see next. So this implies that at least one point must lie on the hyperplane itself, right? Now we come to the proof of this ham sandwich theorem version for the finite point sets. So we'll use the version which we did for the meshes. And the idea is to replace points by tiny balls. Okay. So first of all, we'll do this in three cases. First case is that you assume that each AI has odd cardinality. Okay, there are odd many elements in each of these AIs. Furthermore, if you take their disjoint union, then this is in general position. And this being in general position means that no two points are same. So see, here by abuse of notation, I have put a disjoint union. But if let's say I take a point of A1 and a point of A2, then as it is, if I am forming a set, they should be different elements. Okay. You will say that, oh ma'am, in the disjoint union anyway, they are treated as distinct points. So that is the abuse of notation here that I have done. I am saying that the cardinality of this entire union, disjoint union, should be same as the cardinality of the normal union, which means no two points are same. Okay. And since I'm considering sets, any two points of one set can't be same anyways. Furthermore, no D plus 1 points lie on a common hyperplane. Okay, this is exactly the same way how we defined the geometric simplicial complex long back. So there we wanted them not to lie on a particular Euclidean space. Now, let AI epsilon be the set which you obtain from AI when you have replaced each of the points of AI by a small ball B epsilon AI J. So it's a ball centered at a point AIJ of AI. Its radius is epsilon. Each of the points of AI gets replaced by these balls. Okay. And the union of these J many balls now. So in this notation, I'm already saying that whatever is this highest possible J, this is the cardinality of my set AI. And then the union of these all these balls is the set AI epsilon. Okay, and I choose epsilon to be small enough so that no D plus 1 balls of this entire union can be intersected by a common hyperplane. This can be done. Why? See from the general position which we have assumed, and you should get this answer. Now, moving further, we say, so let H be a hyperplane that simultaneously bisects each of these AI epsilon. This I have from the earlier version, from the mass distributions version of Ham Sandwich theorem. So I have such a hyperplane which is going to simultaneously bisect each of these AI epsilons. Since AI epsilon has odd number of balls, H must intersect at least one of them, correct? Why this is coming? Because we know that if you have a set which has odd number of elements, since each of the open half spaces can contain at most half of these minus the half, therefore one point lies on the hyperplane itself. Therefore, H must intersect at least one of them. Also, at most D balls are intersected all together. Why? What would happen if you intersect more than D balls? Again, question has answer in the general positioning. So H intersects exactly one ball of each AI. Since it has to intersect at least one of them, and at most D balls are intersected all together, and there are D many such sets, therefore H intersects exactly one ball of each of these AI epsilons. Okay. Moreover, H bisects this ball too. Why? Because H is a hyperplane which is bisecting the mass distributions, right? So each of these masses are bisected, which means H is bisecting this particular ball also, and hence H is going to pass through its center, which implies that H bisects each AI itself, correct? So half the, or rather, if let's say AI has 2k sub I plus 1 many points, then H has ki many points on either side of it, and this exactly one point is lying on the edge because H is passing through the center of the ball, which is around the point which is being bisected by the hyperplane H. So this case is done. Now we come to the second case, where we still assume that each AI has odd cardinality. But now we do not assume that the disjoint union of AI, or rather, not really the disjoint union. In book, it's written as union with a dot over it. So just let's say that this is the notation we have. But this union is in any arbitrary position. Now this argument, this particular case can be done using the argument of perturbation. you have to move your sets, points of your sets AI such that this entire union comes into a general position, and then the result would follow. Okay, so please fill in the details and give a mathematical proof for this. So see that in both these cases, we have assumed that the set AI, each of these sets AIs have odd cardinality. What happens if some of the sets have even cardinality? Well, that's pretty easy to handle. If some of the AIs have even cardinality, you pick any arbitrary point from such AIs that are having even cardinality, remove that point, and now all the, so let's say the new collection is some BIs, okay? Now all these BIs have odd cardinality. So you have a hyperplane that bisects all of these simultaneously. Now put the point back in there, okay? And now from the definition of bisecting a set by a hyperplane, you can check that the hyperplane which you got for the BIs is a hyperplane which works for the AIs as well. Okay, so check this and write a formal proof for this. After this, to end this lecture, let's see a general position theorem for the ham sandwich. The last version which we have, it says is that if you have A1, A2, AD, BD many disjoint finite point sets in general position such that no more than D points of this union are contained in any hyperplane, then there is a hyperplane H that bisects each of AIs in a way that each of the open half spaces of H contains at most half the mod AI floor many points, and H itself contains at most one point of AI. Okay, so this is, I'm leaving it as an exercise. This is not hard to prove. So please complete this. And in the next lecture, we'll see probably one more version for the ham sandwich theorem. And then we'll come to the necklace theorem. Okay.